I feel like my process is the same in that I have no process. I feel like every song comes together in a different way. I like lyrics that are maybe like cloudy enough for people to apply their own meaning or to kind of like juxtapose their own life story into the lyrics. I think that helps people connect with songs. I try to pull from multiple things for, you know, in one song, in one verse, I might pull from someone else's struggle, try to juxtapose my life into someone else's struggle. Like, what if that happened to me? Let me write from this person's perspective, assuming I was going through the same thing.
Copeland is a band of many sounds, from pop and emo-fueled indie rock to lush and atmospheric soundscapes. They have always strived to experiment, innovate, and grow every time they put out new music into the world. With over a half a dozen releases spanning over the course of nearly two decades, to say that they have evolved over the years would be an understatement. Over their career, they have toured relentlessly with countless months on the road, and they have built a loyal and dedicated following along the way. When they figured they had peaked, they would announce that they would be breaking up for good, and fans were sure they would never hear another new Copeland record again. After a six-year hiatus, the band would start to release their most compelling work yet. This is the story of Copeland.
If you find yourself here on my side of town, I pray that you'd come to my door.
I started when I was real little, started playing piano, and then through school days went to performing arts high school, playing wind instruments. I kind of dabbled in lots of brass instruments and studied music theory there, and came out of that, started focusing on piano and guitar. Really anything I could get my hand on, I would try to pick up.
Copeland would have humble beginnings in Lakeland, Florida in 1999 as the band Ev Angel.
I think it always interested me. I had, you know, four track and a reel-to-reel eight track and that kind of thing, and would record the high school bands.
In 2000, they released the seven-song EP titled A Beautiful Theme. There are two tracks from this era that were rewritten as future Copeland songs.
We were walking downtown, yeah, the favorite part of town.
The band started in the right place at the right time. The music scene in Central Florida was in full swing. Many bands were starting their careers here during this period, such as Amber Lynn, Under Oath, From First to Last, and Aaron Carter. It was a melting pot of different cities. Orlando, Tampa, Melbourne, Lakeland, and surrounding towns all coalesced into a great music scene which facilitated the growth of the musicians who took part in it. Amidst this Floridian musical mecca, Copeland would face a lot of changes over the following 2 years. James Likeness, who met Aaron as summer camp counselors years prior, would be brought on to play bass. Rusty Fuller would be recruited to play drums.
That awful memory of yours, what a blessing.
In early 2001, to solidify their new lineup, they would change their name from Ev Angel to Copeland after the 20th century composer Aaron Copeland. The band recorded three songs with producer Matt Goldman at his Glow in the Dark studios in Atlanta, and would release them on a split EP with the band Pacifico through the Nashville indie label Theory 8 Records.
First time I heard Copeland, huh? It's gonna have to be when Aaron Hartley, who runs a label called Theory 8, sent the militia group a split record he was doing with a band called Pacifico and a band called Copeland. Instantly, when we heard it, we knew we had to work with Copeland. I would also say it was the first time the militia group ever signed a act without ever seeing them live, or I think even meeting them beforehand, but you could just tell they were special.
In the summer of 2002, the band would replace Thomas Blair with guitarist Brian Morrison. Brian had recently moved from Maryland to Florida for college. He had been working on his own music under the name Modern Day Miracle.
We used to paint this city alive, but now we're just some strangers who say everything's all right.
I was a big sports guy growing up. around 13 or 14 at the beginning of the basketball season. I ended up hurting my back during the first game and had to sit out the whole season because of the injury. And that's when I picked up the guitar. And that was pretty much the turning point from sports into music.
Due to some financial aid issues, he wasn't able to begin school as planned. Coincidentally, Aaron and Brian had both been fans of each other's music through the website mp3.com. After they met up in Lakeland, Aaron asked Brian to record some of his demos to send to the militia group.
So I recorded those with him to kind of show the label. They kind of had this revolving door of drummers and guitar players that they had two or three of each that would just hop on shows whenever they could. So I did a 2-week run and it went well. And so, you know, Aaron was like, do you want to move to Atlanta and start this? So I, at that point, I was, you know, I was kind of homeless living with my friends. So I was like, yeah, definitely.
The band would then relocate to Atlanta as their base of operations to begin work on their first full-length album. They would have continued help from producer Matt Goldman.
Even though the record doesn't sound particularly experimental, we had like an ethic of experimenting. We wanted, you know, we were trying to push boundaries, and I think we pushed boundaries from where we had been.
The album would feature Marsh on vocals, guitar, mellotron, organ, and piano, Likeness on bass and backing vocals, Lawrenson on guitar and piano, and Fuller on drums. Aaron would have an idea vocally, and the band as a whole would contribute to the music and arrangement.
Whenever you do your first record, it's always just like a collection of all the best stuff that you'd done over like a bunch of years, right? Because mm-hmm. you hadn't really made a record yet. So there's stuff from when I was like 17, high school age.
The album features an overarching medical theme, with Aaron stating the inspiration for much of the lyrics being the hospitalization of a girlfriend and the death of his grandmother.
I was like a dude who'd been brokenhearted, who'd been through some difficult emotional times with a girlfriend who was dealing with health problems and lots of other different kinds of stressors. Maybe I was sincere to a fault, you know, like kind of set myself up to maybe never again write anything that like intensely personal. I mean, there are songs on that I wrote the song not thinking that I would ever release it, but just so that the subject matter of the song would hear it.
The album art was an iconic piece of the record upon release. A series of pictures taken at a hospital, the images and overlays add a grounded and raw aesthetic to Beneath Medicine Tree.
See, so the bass player in the band at the time, James, he was a graphic designer also. His main creative input in the band was the graphic side. That was his passion. He had a friend whose mom or aunt or something was a hospital administrator. They let him go in and shoot some beautiful photos of like hospital stuff. It was all kind of cold. And yeah, he just had this great idea for these overlays.
In early 2004, they would release a split record with The Pale. It would feature alternative versions of When Paula Sparks and Testing the Strong Ones. Held down. April would mark the departure of drummer Rusty Fuller. The band stated that Rusty was a huge part of what made up Copeland and that they'll miss him dearly. Say, this is what you get. Their longtime friend and Florida native, Jonathan Bucklew, would take his place. Jonathan had left the band Denison Mars a year prior and had been selling car insurance in the meantime. In August of that year, to give their fans more music while preparing to start on their next album, they would release No Nothing Stays the Same, their EP of covers with remakes of popular songs. At the time, they stated it was a study in the early influence of songs from their childhood and to reflect on their journey as a band. Throughout 2004, the band would constantly be on tour. They would share the stage with dozens of bands within the scene, such as Emery, The Early November, May, Hope's Fall, just to name a few. Before the year was over, they would again enter Goldman's studio in Georgia to start work on their next album. Since the release of Beneath Medicine Tree, which sold less than 200 copies in its first week, Copeland had seen immeasurable growth over the 2 years after it came out. They played over 375 shows in 19 months, which led to a surge in popularity they hadn't quite expected. Their next effort would have a much larger audience and a higher level of public scrutiny.
Now I know if I write something and release it with the name Copeland on it, people are going to hear it. I'm not writing for one person anymore. I'm not writing for myself. I'm not writing for one specific subject. Whether I like it or not, in my head, I know that there's going to be more people hearing it.
Aaron, Brian, James, and newcomer Jonathan would attempt to craft a dancier album this time around. Although Jonathan wasn't a part of the initial songwriting process, his style of drumming changed the final outcome of the record. The band chose to continue working with Matt Goldman due to the relationship they had built up. In an interview with Ant Magazine, Brian stated that they were really comfortable working with him. They were both friends and musicians working together, so that made a big difference. The Militia Group allowed Copeland to have complete creative control over their sound. The band had different moods and ideas in mind that affected their songwriting. After a couple of years of touring with a myriad of different bands, In Motion seemed to have gained a rockier sound than Beneath Medicine Tree. Upon release, In Motion peaked at 115 on Billboard's Top 200. And number 4 on the Heat Seekers New Artist chart, and the boys hit the road on their first headline tour with Acceptance and Love Drug.
You know, In Motion's probably our poppiest record. We sell two more records with Militia Group, so it wasn't like we were trying to shoot for some like major label debut. The pressure was probably more seeing other bands doing well and like, you know, kind of wanting to keep up with the scene to a certain degree.
James would once again handle the overall aesthetic of the release. With an emphasis on simplicity, In Motion showcases a branch with dead leaves against a white background, complementing the band's serious and thoughtful tone. After their In Motion tour, they went out with Daphne Loves Derby and The Spill Canvas. Following that, they had their first overseas tour to Singapore and Japan. In September of 2005, they won the monthly Yahoo Who's Next competition and then hit the UK for a brief tour with Motion City Soundtrack and Circa Survive. In Motion was not Beneath Medicine Tree Part 2, and while some fans were disappointed, many were impressed by the personal and musical growth the band had undergone over the previous 2 years. There were still soft, piano, and acoustic-driven songs. Do what you want, but I know who you are. Do what you want, but I know what you're feeling. However, they incorporated harder songs into the mix. Their lyrics had become more effective, and their music more intricate and sophisticated. The band was riding high on the success of this release. They would finish 2005 and start 2006 with more touring, and headed out on the Screaming Is for Babies tour in February. During a two-month break from the road in spring, they wrote 13 new songs. In the summer, they would once again head to Goldman's studio, hungry to record.
When your whole life is just riding to the next show, loading in, playing the show, and going to sleep, it's only so much you can pull from. It really feels like sometimes you have to take a step back from your daily routine and just try to look at your life as a whole and you seem to get a lot more insight on life.
Copeland went from playing shows with just two girls in the audience a few years earlier to performing in packed venues and at large festivals with hundreds of fans singing along with their songs. They had toured for almost 4 years straight and were dangerously close to being burnt out. After enduring the rigors of touring in motion, the guys took a break from the road in the spring of 2006. During that time, they would journey back to Lakeland to begin writing their next album.
We're here to write our new record in beautiful Danforth Chapel at Florida Southern College in Lakeland, Florida.
We picked this space for a couple reasons. I knew that it didn't get used for much, especially during the summer, and so we made a couple calls and they were kind enough to let us use the space. It definitely helped a lot that I was home. We were able to kind of make our own schedule and write as we felt inspiration. Every other time we've written music, it's always been in a bedroom or a basement or a warehouse.
For the third time, Copeland would utilize Matt Goldman to produce their album.
We've done a lot of records with Matt Goldman. He's done every Copeland release. There's a long history with Matt. And I know on this record we'd pursued a couple other producers just to try something a little different because it was such a drastic change in direction what we were trying to go for. And we'd feel better going someplace where we were comfortable.
While In Motion was created around the idea of making people move, Eat, Sleep, Repeat would see a departure for how the band presented their music, both sonically and lyrically.
I think lyrically, it touches on some of the same emotions that Medicine Treatment. I think people will relate to the lyrics a little bit more than they did In Motion.
They'll certainly find Copeland qualities in it and familiarities.
Eat, Sleep, Repeat is the soundtrack to someone looking inside themselves and realizing what they really need in life but possibly haven't noticed before. This record was the first record that I've ever like made an effort to be almost theatrical with the delivery of the vocals. And my voice isn't very dynamic, so it's a very subtle difference, but just putting a lot more different emphasis, like stronger emphasis on the things that need emphasis and making everything else really tender to just create a much more dynamic vocal performances than I've ever done before.
As for the overall theme of the album, in an interview with the website Loud Rock Portal, Aaron stated that there weren't any particular themes or concepts, but that the common mood and inspiration are sleepless nights and feeling like you're looking for something important.
You're
While still signed with the militia group, Copeland would continue to use their creative freedom to push their music in new directions.
For one, we knew that was going to be our last record with the militia group. And so it kind of felt inevitable that the record after Eat Sleep Repeat would probably end a major. So I think there was a little bit of this, let's experiment now while like there's no one telling us what we should and shouldn't do it. Mm. Like we can do whatever we want.
The album still had pieces of Beneath Medicine Tree, and Remnants of In Motion. However, Eat, Sleep, Repeat would mostly tread new waters for the band. While the record may have a darker vibe overall, it has more symphonic elements than either of the two past releases. Aaron's arrangement skills are on full display as the album gets increasingly orchestral throughout the playtime. As for the aesthetic of the album, the artwork seems harmless at first, but on closer inspection, it has a spooky and mysterious quality to it.
We had a pretty dark sound for the record. I had some samples of artwork by an artist named Jamie Adams. Late one night, I was going through the samples and realized that one of the paintings really, really matched the sound of the record. It just perfectly fit the sound more than I guess I had even thought.
Eat, Sleep, Repeat was released to eager fans on October 31st, 2006. It reached 90 on the Billboard charts, their highest ranking album to date. After three successful releases, the band would find themselves in the big leagues. Columbia Records announced signing Copeland in a press release on November 14, 2006. Although this was a very exciting moment in their career, it didn't come without contention.
The record, basically, once it was done, before it came out, Columbia heard it and decided they wanted it. Columbia essentially bought us out once the wheels were in motion. Militia Group no longer had any stake in the record. There was no reason to promote a record they weren't going to own. But the logistics of it getting to Columbia took so long that by the time they like they were ready to push the record, it had been out for a few months, and they kind of essentially didn't want to push an old record.
In the face of these issues, the guys would continue to tour their new music around the country. They went out with Switchfoot in early 2007, opened for the Goo Goo Dolls in the spring, and played some shows with Amber Lynn in Asia and Australia in the summer. After being a part of Copeland for 6 years, James would make public his decision to no longer be a part of the band. Wanting to pursue his career as a graphic designer, he went on to work with To Write Love in Our Arms and his own company, Tired Children. Dean Lawrence would serve as the band's primary touring bassist for the next several years. If losing a longtime member wasn't enough, during a September tour with The Rentals, the band announced that they had left Columbia Records. less than a year after being signed. They hadn't even started their next album.
And this was kind of the point in the industry where everything was just imploding in on each other. Very quickly decided, like, they wanted us to start focusing on the next record. So Eat Sleep Repeat kind of got pushed aside. Our almost entire team got fired. So it took a while just for us to get noticed, like, oh, hey, we're here. We're supposed to be making a new record. Essentially, eventually, they dropped us. Like, we basically spent a while in our management lawyer just saying, like, drop us, please. Like, you don't, there's no reason for us to be here.
Just let me run where I want to run. Just let me love who I want.
Shortly after their industry struggles, they released Dressed Up and In Line through the Militia Group. The album was originally planned to be a two-disc collection featuring re-recordings of old songs. But at the time, Aaron's voice had become fatigued from touring. It ultimately included a mix of B-sides, rarities, acoustic recordings, and remixes. In late 2007, Brian's younger brother, Steven, would officially join the band as an additional guitarist.
He was actually only 17 on the first tour he did with us. Wow. And it got to the point where Aaron was doing so much piano that we just needed another guitar player. You break your neck to keep your
chin up. Although the release cycle of Eat, Sleep, Repeat started as a high point for the band, it was ultimately a tumultuous time. They would push through the difficulties and continue to play a handful of shows during the rest of 2007 and early 2008, but they gradually fell silent on their website and social media platforms. Fans waited patiently and wondered what the band would do next.
Fortunately for us, hard times have always served to be a good source of inspiration, and we never wanted industry letdowns to keep us from doing what we love. So we took some time off. Started writing songs again slowly, not even really sure if there would be a label on board to release what we were working on. This cloudy future of ours seemed to be a good catalyst for creativity.
Copeland had seemingly disappeared, and fans weren't really expecting a new album anytime soon. However, in August of 2008, they would update their MySpace page, and with a mysterious marketing campaign, they would announce that they had signed with Tooth & Nail Records and that they would be releasing a new album later in the year. They would have the most music and material prepared before recording than any of their previous albums.
I knew that I wanted a producer who had a knack for manipulating sounds because I wanted the record to have the organic feel of past Copeland records with an added otherworldly quality.
They spent some time in a North Carolina cabin to flesh out the songs. And after a week, they drove to Compound Studios in Seattle to meet up with producer Aaron Sprinkle.
Working with Aaron Marsh was definitely a one-of-a-kind experience for me. He had such a clear vision, like walking into the studio with exactly what he wanted to hear coming out of the speakers. And not only that, but it was a beautiful vision, and he had the ability to realize it in a way that I hadn't really ever seen before.
I really liked the idea of juxtaposing very human sounds with very synthetic ones. I got a call from my friend Aaron Sprinkle. He's a producer that I really respect and coincidentally has a keen ability to manipulate sounds.
After spending some time practicing in Sprinkle's studio, the demos continued to develop and started to take shape. They continued to experiment and utilize interesting tools and ideas which helped them to build the sound of their new songs.
For example, one of the pianos that Sprinkle had at his studio was a bit out of tune when we got there, but in a nice way. It didn't sound nasty, just had some character to it. We liked the way that it sounded a bit pitchy for some songs, but we really wanted it to be in tune on others. So we scheduled a piano tuner to come in halfway through the process. So we recorded all of the out-of-tune piano first and saved all of the pitch-perfect piano parts for the end.
Since Sprinkle was also a vocalist, it allowed him and Aaron to easily communicate their ideas and effectively track what was in Aaron's head. The lyrics and melodies have a subtle intensity that rises and falls throughout the album.
We had the pleasure of getting some really great horn players to record on a few songs. Dan Batchelor played clarinet, Jacob Kaufman played bassoon, Robert Parker played trumpet and flugelhorn. These were all Seattle musicians that we contacted through a friend of the studio manager. They were really great players and really easy to work with. So having some great horn players come in was a real treat for me. I think my favorite moment on the entire record is on the last track, Not So Tough, when the bassoon comes in and echoes the melody that Ray Cassidy sang. Kind of reminds me a bit of Peter and the Wolf. We've had the pleasure of having some great guest vocalists on each of our records. So when we started talking about who would be on this record, Ray Cassidy was one of the first people I thought of. Luckily for us, she was kind enough to come and sing on our record.
The sky, even on your grayest night, could you be happy now with the wind in your hair and your eyes open wide and your feet going nowhere?
Aaron came across Cassidy on MySpace a few years prior and was enamored by her music. When the opportunity arose for guest vocals on the album, she was the perfect choice.
The process of recording the strings for this record was a little bit different. All the strings were recorded in Kansas by a guy named Chris Carmichael. I didn't even get to meet him. We never spoke face to face, we only corresponded over email. I would write the parts, then send him sheet music along with a rough mix of the song, and then he'd record those parts at his studio in Kansas, send the tracks back to us. This was kind of a different way of recording for me. I was kind of nervous at first about not being there for the recording of the strings. But when it was all said and done, everything came out great. He did a magnificent job on the parts, and I was actually kind of bummed that I didn't have more parts for him to record on every song.
After working on the record for months with no label, they would sign with Tooth & Nail Records, who would handle the distribution of the album. Copeland came to the table with ambitious ideas, and luckily, the label was open to their requests on how You Are My Sunshine would be presented.
The aesthetic that we were going for on the record was, you know, this this line between lovely and creepy, that if you imagine a photograph of a lovely field full of flowers, or a little girl standing in a field full of flowers, it would be just a lovely image. But if there was an ominous shadow kind of looming that you couldn't tell what was just out of frame, all of a sudden you would have a very spooky photo. It's like this line that's like so thin. It's an aesthetic that we've really been fascinated with since we started making the third record.
Now we'll all
The album art features a faded image of treetops and an overcast sky. Along with other desaturated visuals, the record's aesthetic was grounded yet surreal. The pictures were taken by photographer Jeff Carver using a Holga camera, which is a medium format film camera known for its low fidelity aesthetic. In the moments before time starts moving backward. You Are My Sunshine was released to the world on October 14th, 2008. It was mixed by Grammy-winning engineers Michael Brower and Will Hensley. The album peaked at 48 on the charts, beating Eat Sleep Repeat's position just 2 years earlier. After the release, they would perform a headline tour with Lydia, Lights, and Love Drug. They took a couple months off from the road in early 2009, and during that time, they released the Gray Man EP, which had the bonus tracks from the vinyl release of the record. In April, they would go on tour with This Providence, and then another tour in the summer with Sherwood and Anchor and Braille. The band loved to perform their music live, but the road started to take its toll.
You see, the night is all I have to make me feel, and all I want is just the love to make it hurt.
You know, I didn't love, like, road life. You know, people are pretty well aware of the fact that I don't really love being on tour, but I do love just being on stage and just, like, creating something and having the crowd kind of feel that energy. And yeah, there's kind of nothing like it.
After a tour supporting Reliant K in the fall, Copeland would announce the unthinkable.
At this point, you had to still tour a lot, and none of us really loved touring, especially Aaron and I. So it got to the point where it just kind of felt like we were spinning our wheels.
Over like 10 years or 9 years of touring, we hit a lot of those benchmarks, and I think we just felt like we didn't have any more goals that were like reasonably attainable, and we just decided to just go ahead and do one victory lap and call it quits.
On October 29th, 2009, after everything they had endured as a band, Copeland would reveal that they would be parting ways and cease making music together.
I think part of that is our own doing, and I think like the writing felt like it was on the wall, so right. Do we just let this go and watch it dwindle forever, or do we kind of call it what it is, and if we kind of handle our goodbye and our, you know, do a farewell tour on our terms versus just waiting until it's over. That's kind of what it felt like we were heading that way.
Fully aware that the breakup would be disappointing to fans, they performed a farewell tour in March and April of 2010 as a parting gift to their supporters, friends, and family. They would finish the tour with two nights in Central Florida and then start the next chapter of their lives.
Brian and Steven, the two brothers in the band, they started a new band called States. They've already started working on that music. And I'm sure John will do another band. But yeah, I think we all still want to do music. It's just this editing season has passed for Copeland.
Copeland run its course as far as you felt emotionally that it had, or were there financial diminishing returns and less people coming to shows?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit of everything. You know, I mean, Copeland was a band for over 10 years, or almost 10 years. It was just starting to fall apart a little bit, and I think everyone just wanted a different shift.
2010 and beyond was an increasingly somber time for Copeland fans. It gave us time to reflect on the body of work that the group had created and to enjoy the songs that they had made. Taking a step away from the band allowed each of the members to branch out and try new things. Aaron would start his own recording studio, The Vanguard Room, while also creating experimental hip-hop songs under the name The Lulz in Traffic. Jonathan and his wife would start a successful furniture building company named 1720. He would also join Dean, Brian, and Steven to start the band States, featuring Mindy White from Lydia. States would go on to release two full-length albums, Room to Run through Tooth and Nail and Paradigm, which they funded through a Kickstarter campaign. The crowdfunding effort was a surprising success. With a goal of $18,000, the campaign would exceed expectations and would ultimately receive well over enough to fund the project. After experiencing this incredible support from fans, the Copeland boys started to consider if they could release an album utilizing these new crowdfunding methods.
You know, kind of started to feel like we wanted to do it again. We had songs. We had like our lives opened up to like do this again.
In April of 2014, they would announce their reunion and that their next album, Ixora, would come out later in the year. It had been 6 years since You Are My Sunshine was released. Longtime listeners weren't sure what to expect from the band, and Copeland wasn't sure what to expect from the fans. They would release pre-orders for Ixora upon announcement, 6 months prior to the official release date.
Today was fine. I woke up late like I always do.
The album would inadvertently start with the creation of the song Ordinary, which Aaron wrote for a movie before there was even talk of a new record, and it wasn't meant to be a Copeland song at all.
And when I returned,
the band has always had a lot of freedom when it came to their music. And since the album would be recorded at Aaron's home studio, the band had even more control.
We'll find tomorrow is just ordinary too.
Hey, my name is Aaron Marsh, and I am a music producer at the Vanguard Room in Lakeland, Florida. This studio is a recording studio. We have three live rooms where we make noise and two control rooms, and the studio is full of musical instruments and different vintage gear, anything that would foster an environment that would cause a songwriter to write a new song or an artist to reapproach the way that they write or foster any kind of new creativity.
And John was busy with his furniture during the whole thing, so he was only in, you know, out of the 3 months that we worked on it, he was probably in for 3 days, you know.
Wow.
So for most of it, it was just Brian and Steven and I, just the three of us in the studio, you know, putting this record together, writing, kind of experimenting with the sound. So it was different. It felt incredibly isolated.
The record would see an increase of electronic elements throughout the runtime, and Steven would have a more active role in songwriting than he had in the past. This is apparent on the track Chiromancer. Arizona singer-songwriter Steph Copen would lend her vocals to the track as well. The songs were barely demoed during recording, as Aaron prefers the in-the-moment approach, which makes the process more spontaneous.
If only I could call up through the void to reach you. If only I could stretch across the depths to hold you.
Lyrically, most of the songs on the record are about Aaron's family. Ixora was accompanied by a sister release called Ixora Twin, which, if played at the same time as the main record, acts as a complimentary remix of sorts. Each song lines up and adds several layers to the entire album, creating a quadraphonic listening experience.
We committed to doing it and announced it before we actually like attempted to see how easy it would be, which was probably not very smart of us. And it was so I think the majority of Twin was done in a couple of weeks. And granted, while we were making Ixora, sometimes if there was an element or a part that for whatever reason wasn't sitting right, or there were times where we'd be like, oh, let's hold on to that and use that for Twin. So some of the elements of Twin we had tracked during Ixora.
This concept of two complementary albums with mirror track lists had never really been attempted prior to this, and it was an impressive feat. Aaron has stated he wouldn't do it again under the same circumstances, as it was very difficult, especially with the small amount of time that they had to complete it.
Take me now, take me anywhere you're going. 'Cause I can't stay here, I won't make it long. And this piece of my soul you're controlling. In this time and this space where we belong.
While still writing and recording, the album pre-orders kept rolling in. It was nearly funded only 3 days after the announcement. The support was fierce from eager fans.
Take me down. When I feel like I'm dead, you're reviving.
Aaron stated that the album was to be an immersive experience and have an all-around sinking feeling, and the water and ocean backdrop helps to signify this.
A billion stars and here we are, the same bit of dirt holding our way.
Ixora's album art features the title in hand-brush calligraphy. The flower featured as the centerpiece is the Ixora flower. Ixora was released on November 24th, 2014, and made it to 93 on the Billboard Top 200, and the band noted it was the best first week that they'd ever had. Overall, the album was a shift for the band, but upon reflection, some songs were reminiscent of You Are My Sunshine.
And now I'll close your eyes for going under.
In the early stages of Ixora's production, the band was very upfront with their lack of desire to tour it. However, as time went on and the reception pouring in was increasingly positive, they reconsidered their decision.
We just really, really believed in the songs and, you know, rather than just let it just fizzle out on iTunes, we figured we'd do a little bit of touring and see if we can, you know, get it heard by some folks, yeah.
Bobby Walker would join as their touring bassist in 2014, and Jordan Butcher would take over on drums the following year. Their first outing in 5 years would be a tour with Paramore in the spring of 2015. 6 months later, they would head out with Isley and We Are the City. At the end of 2016, they would embark on their now/then tour, playing songs from all of their previous releases. Brian stated, quote, "This is the most ambitious set we've ever done. It's a tip of the hat to our history as a band. We wanted to celebrate each record as a whole and do a tour that was more progressive and expansive." Copeland had made their most complete album to date. With their time away from the band, they each continued working on music in their own ways. From the Laurensons and Bucklew starting states, and Marsh producing in his studio, they had gained valuable experience they may not have had if they continued directly after You Are My Sunshine. This is apparent in the growth, maturity, and cohesiveness Ixora presents.
and you felt the world turn.
And I saw in a Twitter Q&A, you guys kind of hinted at the possibility of doing another album. Is that a thing?
Yeah. I think we've decided that we want to do another one. We don't really know when. We don't have any songs, and we don't really know. We don't have any ideas for what it would be, but I think we've been stewing on the idea of doing another one. So I think it probably will happen.
After their breakup in 2010 and Meteoric returned to form in 2014, Copeland was a band once again. Only planning to do a CD release show for Ixora, they ended up hitting the road for a season of touring for the album. Before they knew it, they were back to playing shows and writing music.
I guess creatively, we're kind of in a place now, we can kind of do things on our terms. We kind of all have other things in life, other ventures, and really the process of making Copeland Records is just completely creative for us now.
In 2016, they would embark on their most ambitious album to date, one that would take over 3 years to release.
I mean, I think just by default, we just immediately darken sounds, yeah. Kind of reduce the high end. This is like our go-to, and I think that kind of makes that slightly like underwater feel. Things like kind of reverberating, but in a dark, kind of muted tone.
The overall sonic signature of Blushing was turning out to be ambient and melancholy, but also intense and earnest. The lyrics were intriguing and deeply introspective.
These days I'm terrified of silence. My thoughts unbearable in the quiet.
Yeah, there's a lot of darkness, a lot of kind of dealing with like depression and definitely that flip side of romance where you're, you know, discontent or wanting more.
Step lightly, we might sink in. City life.
Getting the album mixed would prove to be the most time-consuming part, as they waited patiently to work with producer Michael Brower.
The Blushing process took way longer because he was working out of Electric Lady Studios in New York and was building his own place so he could kind of start working for more indie bands because his overhead was so high where he was. So long story short, we waited about 8 months. We were like 90 to 95% of the record was tracked late 2017. We didn't go up there till August, last year.
In October of 2018, with the album finally finished, Copeland would attempt their most challenging live performance to date. Collaborating with Florida Southern College, the band would do a full 12-song set accompanied by the Imperial Symphony Orchestra.
Okay, so I was definitely the most stressed out I've ever been for any show. It's because I've spent 3 months pretty much full time just writing arrangements, 50-piece orchestra, and they were like all pretty full, you know, like the symphonic percussion, keys, harp, multiple string parts, all the woodwinds, brass, I mean, the works. So like that, the next day, I had no idea what to do with myself.
And though I never belonged on this pebble where I stand, heaven knows what I, heaven knows what I am.
After their orchestral outing, and leading up to the release of Blushing, they put out their first single, Pope, on November 7th.
Until I can prove that this world is not me.
They followed that with the release of both Night Figures and On Your Worst Day on December 6th, and finally, Lay Here on January 20th.
And can we just lay here?
I don't think it's a huge jump. I think it sounds, to me, it sounds like exaggerated Copeland. Probably the only thing we leaned into harder than most people would expect would be kind of like the kind of like groovy, like R&B type of vibes.
Was it cool to the touch? I can almost feel it. I know.
Blushing was still distinctly Copeland. However, they had pushed their sound to its limits.
Lingers, but you know I can't sleep with my head like that. I just stay right here.
The track Skywriter, with its soaring strings and gentle piano, would feature Nashville-based musician Young Summer.
It might just make you crazy.
To the wind blow you down, down. Was it your greatest enemy?
And so I think now, whenever we start working on the record, my mind is already turning about like, who is it going to be for this one? So, and her voice is, she has this like real deep, smoky voice. We never had anything like that.
What's the point of searching if I just end up lost?
The band leaned into their fascination with dreams and nightmares on the album as a whole.
Yeah.
Night figures all around us. Night figures they surround us while I kiss you in the dark.
It's nice to pull it from a dream because, you know, it's just like a little different, a little skewed than the normal stuff.
Finally released Blushing on Valentine's Day of 2019, and it reached 45 on the Billboard charts, making it the most successful record release of their career.
Don't count me out, I feel you.
After years of putting in hard work on their own, the band had seemingly found their place in the modern musical landscape. They could create music on their terms, writing and recording at home, spending time with their loved ones, and making space for other endeavors. The life of constant touring and hopping from city to city was behind them. The question was, what was in front of them?
There's probably gonna be some conversations over the next few months of kind of like, what's, like, what are our goals beyond? You know, I think this record felt like it took so long. Eventually, you know, not that we thought it wouldn't come out, but I think we're kind of, kind of excited about what comes next, even though we haven't quite figured it out.
There's plenty of time left tonight. I promised I'd have you home before daylight. We do the best we can. Small town, act like big city kids when the sun goes down. If it's not too late for coffee, I'll be at your place in 10. We'll hit that all-night diner and then